You don't know if you're going to get it or not, right? You just demand it. Well, if somebody else has a stronger need than you have, then your demand may not be met. Or if somebody just doesn't want to comply with you, your demand may not be met. If you have a need, you're either going to get the need, or, you know, something bad is going to happen to you. So when we talk about demand, we're usually talking about supply and demand in a marketplace. And that kind of demand is not, well, let's put it this way, I'll ask you, do you think something like that, a marketplace demand, constitutes a reason for taking eminent domain because of a need? And that's kind of an open question. I don't think so, but that's what the, that's part of the open question here. So really when we talk about this, we have to talk about it in terms of what are our energy needs and how do those juxtapose against the demands that the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission is going to be focusing on, because they look at numbers, they look at assets, they look at business growth and development, and they think about what they think is the greater good. Whether that greater good is truly a greater good or not is up for grabs. And so to come up with compelling arguments, you need to be able to fight these fights. And that's what energy needs are about. Daniel Sad, the president of Liberty Utilities, the largest natural gas distributor in New Hampshire, said, it's pretty simple. We've got renewables, we've got all kinds of solutions, but at the end of the day, if you want to knock these prices down, if you want to buffer them for the long term, a natural gas pipeline has to go through this state. That's what he said. So that's what we need to do, according to him. So more gas pipelines means lower energy prices. That's what he says. Have you ever heard this meme? Clean, cheap, reliable. You've probably heard it in your sleep. Probably heard it while you were sleeping in front of the TV, and it's probably been sitting in your brain for centuries, if you're as old as I am. And you don't even know it, because it's a meme. Clean, cheap, reliable, it's a meme. And what does it mean? Your neighbor might have told you, clean, cheap, reliable. Your neighbor might think, well, that's all I know about gas, clean, cheap, and reliable. Why would anyone care about anything else, right? Well, here's a question. Why did ISO New England is the group that regulates, that provides our wholesale market for energy, okay? ISO, Independent System Operator, New England, their grid manager, why would he promote the use of expensive oil reserves on a wholesale market? Well, because using liquefied natural gas to keep winter gas and electric prices down would lower gas prices and send the wrong signal about the relative scarcity of natural gas. Does that, any of that make sense to you? What he's saying is, last winter, there was an opportunity to put liquid natural gas on the marketplace. He decided that that's not a good idea, because if we put that natural gas on the market, it's going to put the price of natural gas lower. And if we put the price of natural gas lower, what's going to happen? The price is going to go lower. And what's that going to mean? It's going to mean that we don't have demand. And what's that going to mean? We can't build pipelines. Now, that's an implicit statement. He could deny that if he wanted to. But that's effectively what it means. And so various dual plants had to use jet, and reserve plants had to use jet fuel in order to get through the winter. Very costly. Not a good idea. Sounds like a lot of things that aren't very market free market conducive to me. So regional reliability, what's that? Regional reliability is how do we get reliable energy to our region. NESCO is a group that Doug told me about, New England States for Commission on Energy. They had a final report commissioned by to Black and Veatch, a company that wrote the report, and it was a gas, it was called the gas study. And they were trying to figure out whether it makes sense to bring more gas to New England. All the six New England governors got together and said, maybe we should do this. So they got together and they determined out of this study, now keep in mind some things about New England. Our growth rates are somewhere between 1% and 2%. So at the low end, we're a little below low 1%. The high end, we're a little above 2%. Okay, we're not a massively growing economic powerhouse, but we're growing. And so we have some demands for we have a shortfall, right, what do we do with natural gas? We use it to heat homes, and we use it to generate power. And there's about a 50-50 split on that in terms of how we utilize it. And the preference goes to the home heating people because you wouldn't want someone to freeze just so that you can make electricity, right? So ICE in New England determined that given a normal growth rate, that we have a projected shortfall of 700 megawatts of energy on our grid. And that includes not having the 900 megawatts for Yankee and the decommissioned oil and coal that's going offline. What they ignored is that in that gas study, they said there would be no long-term infrastructure solutions necessary under a low-demand scenario. Low-demand scenario is, you know, the 1% or less than 1% growth. Under those scenarios, there's no need for anything. And that was ignored. And a lot of these people who have these bright shirts in the back are in part responsible for the fact that there's now an investigation in Massachusetts to determine if a low-demand study scenario could actually be viable, at least in Massachusetts. Now, when we get to preemption and all that, we get to the FERC, and, you know, it opens questions about whether, you know, Massachusetts could say that, you know, their energy policy is to consider alternatives to natural gas, and what would happen, and how that would get regulated. But we're talking about, so we see this basic split, and we see that there's just a general slow movement towards more use of gas and electricity and heating. The core problem is there are sharp increases in demand for gas. They cause spikes, and they're costly. And spikes are not the result of being fully subscribed. You can get spikes when you're at about 75% subscribed. What subscribe is the pipe itself. Think of it as like a pie chart, right? Everybody gets a segment of the pipe. And if it's not fully subscribed, there's segments left that aren't being used, okay? So at about 75% capacity, you start getting price spikes. That suggests that gas, natural gas, has extreme volatility to it. Okay, so here's an example of what we're talking about. In 2015, there's expected to be this dashed line. It shows that, there's 365 days out of the year. And when we have peak demand, those peak demand days, you can see this sort of parabolic movement of the chart, where all of a sudden there's just this high demand, right? Okay. And then here you can kind of quantify how much you're actually getting. That little green part is how much, what's called peak shaving. It's how you deal with your peak demand requirements. There's a little bit of peak demand shaving, peak shaving going on, and then there's additional supply that's needed somehow, somewhere, right, that we don't necessarily have. We can't get it from a pipe, because there's either the pipe's not working at capacity, but we can't get one through it for one reason or another, or it is at capacity, and we need some alternative. And all of what's going on in this report, this gas study report, is based on those parabolic points. It's based on how much do we need to accomplish those peak moments. So somebody recently in an article said something about, it's the equivalent of putting a six-lane superhighway in Nantucket to manage traffic on the 4th of July. It's perfect, perfect analogy, right? Because that's what we're doing. So NESCO went and solicited a group that works basically for the industry. It's a kind of the mouthpiece for the gas and oil industry called NEPOOL. And they determined for New England that there is no market-based solution that can solve regional reliability. There's no market-based solution. Think back to what happened earlier when there appeared to be some price fixing on the market. Well, there's no market solution. What does that suggest to you? It suggests to me that if there's no market solution, then we can't go by market-based principles to determine what to do, right? What are we going to do? Well, guess what they chose to do? Let me tell you what I would do first. If I were the governor, okay, and I were looking at this problem, I would say Massachusetts has big goals here, 1,600 megawatts of solar power by 2020. Their regional gas initiative says 2,000 megawatts of wind power by 2020. New Hampshire has 25% renewables by 2025. The Global Warming Solutions Act in Massachusetts says 25% renewables by 2020. ISO New England says one-third of the New England energy mix has to be renewables by 2022. ISO New England says that. Global Warming Solution Act, here's the kicker, says 80% renewables by 2050, based on 1990 emissions levels. Most of what President Obama's talking about are not 1990 levels. He's talking about 2005 levels. They're talking about a real solution here, a real solution. Because if you look at 350.org, for instance, their advice on the 2 degrees Celsius catastrophic issue that we want to avoid, right? Irreversible damage from climate change happens if we achieve this number, 80% renewables by 2050. If we can achieve that, we potentially achieve the avoidance of the catastrophic failures from a 2% centigrade rise in temperature that we're trying to avoid. I'm not going to be talking about global warming and trying to convince anybody of whether global warming is real or not. You can put that aside any way you'd like. Actually, I'll say one thing. If global warming doesn't exist, why are insurance companies changing actuarials as we speak? Okay, enough said.
Why have their predictions been wrong for 20 years?
So, the annual greenhouse gas emissions and future limits. The projection here is to get to 2025 by with the global storm.